Now, you might be asking why we refer to Wanjiko as Wanjiko when we're talking about policy making, when we're talking about business, and so many other things. Well, the word, or rather the term Wanjiko, was coined after the presence of mama mboga in the market. Statistically speaking, is that over 50% of small businesses owned in the private sector, what we want to refer to as jua kali, are owned by women. And despite government interventions over the last few years to just have women included in policy making in as far as the economy and finances are concerned, well, they're still left out. So there's still gaps. And that's why this morning we're talking about women and the economy. How do we harness their full potential? Joining me this morning on set are two ladies. On my immediate left is none other than Dr. Mary Mbithi, who is a senior lecturer of economics at the University of Nairobi, and also is the director of research at the Women's Economic Empowerment Hub. Karibu sana, daktari.
Thank you.
On my far left, we have Njeri Karuru, who is a researcher at the Women's Economic Empowerment Hub, as well as she is also working with the African Women's Studies Center. This morning, we're talking about the gaps that we have and that are, you know, holding back women as far as financial inclusion, economic empowerment, as well as, you know, participation as far as economic development is concerned. Remember, we are open to your views. What do you think is holding back women from actually sitting at the table? Daktari, we start off with our question. What do you think, from where you sit, what's your opinion? What is holding us back?
Thank you. There are several things that are holding women back from, you know, participating, fully participating in the economy. Mm-hmm. And if we look at it, there are really many gaps, which we may want to call gender gaps, mm-hmm. or really the gaps between men and women. To begin with is educational attainment. And educational attainment, if you look at it, you find that generally women are less, you know, there's a gap between women and men when it comes to educational attainment. Also, the issue of skill, you find that there's the difference between women and men when it comes to the skills that are needed in the marketplace. And these are some of the things that are holding women back from participating in the economy. If you take an example of, for example, educational attainment, if an employer there, whether the government or the private sector, wants to employ somebody, they will require a certain, you know, set of education, as well as education skills. And here, if the women are less, you know, when it's compared to men, then they cannot be able to get the requirements for that particular place. Mm-hmm. So that odds women even getting into the employment and the workplace. The same when it comes to the skills, then you find that again, because of gender norms, women tend to believe that, or the society expects women, you know, to they attain certain skills or they participate in certain sectors, mm-hmm. of the economy. Mm-hmm. And that way, women also, on their part, tend to prefer certain areas of training. Mm-hmm. For example, education to become teachers or nurses, which are good, you know, they are good employment places, and that service is needed in the economy. But again, it's like the norms, the society expects them to participate in that place. So when that happens, that leads to segregation, mm-hmm. In the workplace, such that you find women tend to be more in the nursing sector or more in the teaching sector, and probably they may not want to engage in other sectors which are also lucrative, mm-hmm. when it comes to employment and earning more and also participating in certain sectors of the economy, mm-hmm. that are important for development, such as industry and so on.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Doctor, we will be coming back to you as we tackle the issue of societal norms as holding back women, okay. you know, to achieving greatness.
Yes.
Let's rope in our researcher, and that is none other than Njeri Karuru. What do you think is holding back women, you know, from engaging in, you know, economic development? We've had Daktari here say that education attainment, then also lack of skills, as well as societal norms. Mm. In your perspective, what else?
I think what we call society norms are the cultural and patriarchal structures that have continuously subjugated women to a lesser class than men. Mm-hmm. And also I see it as a process, a historical process. because even in the post, during the colonial period, men were offered opportunities to go to work, to go to school more than women. And this has carried on over time, such that men have always led in terms of getting access to school, getting access to employment. So women are playing a catch-up game. So in that catch-up game, the policies are also not supporting, have not always supported that equality and that, you know, inclusion of women. So we see opportunities coming up in terms of affirmative action, where the government is now trying to bring in women through, you know, university education, through all areas. Because what we see historically is that, women tend not to, they start almost at the same level with men in terms of early education. But when you go to tertiary education, they go dropping out. That means, therefore, that even those getting into the market to compete are fewer. And therefore, you know, that lack of equality in competition is there. Mm-hmm. So whereas the government has tried lately to bring up policies that, affirmative action funds that, bring women on board, there's that cultural norms and societal attitudes still accept that, the economy is designed to benefit men in terms of men having access to more collateral than women. So when women want to take loans to develop, they don't have collateral to support the applications for loans. So, and that is also a patriarchal cultural issue. Mm-hmm. So all those things come to play, such that even women start self-censorship, where they feel they can't,
Where you're expected to be modest, that if you went for that managerial job, exactly, will turn you to be more of a man, less of a woman.
You don't apply. In fact, one HR person was saying that when a job is advertised, more men are likely to apply even when they don't meet the qualifications, but women want to read the application and only apply if it's 100% fit for them, whereas a man will apply if it's 50% fit. So those are some of the self-censorships that we see. And I don't think women fail to... There is also an element of the roles women have. Uh-huh. When you think about the domestic roles, the reproductive roles, they tend to, do I leave my child and go look for a job, or do I first take care of this child? My mother-in-law is sick, what do I do? So there are the domestic roles that women affect women more than men. So it's a package.
It's a whole package.
Yeah.
Now, talking about, we've already established that indeed there are gaps, societal norms, education skills. And I know we're doing something about it, or rather the Women and the Economic Conference is targeting to try and correct this situation. Mm. So talking about this particular conference that is going to be happening today and tomorrow, what is the main objective of the Women and the Economic Conference, Dr. Rimbithi?
The main objective is to enhance participation of women in the economy, participation of women in the marketplace, whether it is in the employment place or whether it is in the business sphere. So because there are so many gaps which will hinder women, as we have seen, to participate in the employment place as well as in the marketplace. So what the conference wants to attain is to discuss these issues together, to discuss what is this that is holding women and what are the opportunities which are out there for women and what is government doing, mm-hmm. What are some of the policies that government is advancing, to promote women participation in the economy. And related to that, the conference will be discussing several issues related to agribusiness, related to micro, small, and medium enterprises, which is really touching small-scale businesses, mm-hmm. where the majority of the people are women. It will also talk about taxation and policy regimes. How do they impact on the women? And what are the best kind of taxes that can enhance that small scale woman, mm-hmm. to participate in a business or to grow a business? It will also discuss issues related to access to finance. That small scale woman What are the chances, what are the opportunities that the woman has, and how can they access finances so that they'll be able to invest more in their businesses and be able to grow those businesses, as well as discussing planning and budgeting for inclusive participation of women, mm-hmm. basically looking at what are some of those things, you know, that government can do so that they enhance the budgeting when we do national budgeting and the count budget, so that it takes into account activities that involve women. This include women businesses as well as those other sectors where women participate most, including those activities which we may call non-productive, where women spend a lot of time on. These include things like childcare, early childhood education. They also include the health sector. They also include the water, because we know those are some of the water sector. Mm-hmm. We know those are some of the sectors where women are involved in at the household level, and because the woman is concerned about the children, the well-being, yes. taking care, whether
they're
going to school.
She's the custodian of the home.
Exactly, yes. Custodian of the home. Mm-hmm. Is the water there? So when we have budgeting, for example, that takes into account those sectors where women spend a lot of time in, mm-hmm. and those are the ones we call non-productive, because they are not in the marketplace. The woman is not spending time there, you know, to make some income or to involve in business or employment. So those activities, if there is some money, a good allocation of the budget going there, then that reduces the burden that the woman has with regards to those unproductive activities.
Unproductive activities. Childcare, water, sanitation, and such. We will be getting back to it. Now let's look at the low-hanging fruits. We are all dealing with this pandemic, and we've seen the emerging trends in the market. Mm. So where are the low-hanging fruits for a woman who is probably watching Good Morning Kenya this morning and wanting to know, if I was to get into business, if I was to get into a small business, which sectors would prove, you know, fruitful in the long term and in the medium term, actually even in the short term? Where are the low-hanging fruits? Madam Jerry.
Yeah, I think the service industry is an area people have to eat. So, you know, food production would be key. And businesses around, you know, the service industry would be important, particularly food-related areas. In terms of how they can get into that, I think one of the things the conference is going to highlight is a question of sharing information, because there are so many funds that exist, yet women do not know they exist, or if they know, maybe they don't know how to get them. We find that, you know, government offers contracts through the Access to Government Opportunities program. And here women can get contracts to supply the small, you know, small businesses and even big businesses. But it's because you asked about the low-hanging fruits that I'm starting with the small businesses. And then we also have, the government has also started a new fund to cater for this time of COVID, which is a credit guarantee scheme, mm-hmm. where it will guarantee women and men to get loans from banks to revive their businesses, because many women have businesses that collapsed during that time.
Yes.
So there are opportunities where, you know, with support from government and other partners, they can access the credit guarantee scheme, which will mean the government guarantees them to take some loans to help them in their daily work. So that, and also other, I'm talking about government funds because, you know, they are not as expensive as bank loans. So you have the Kenya Women Enterprise Fund that gives women, loans. We have the Youth Fund, which is for both men and women, and it can also provide funds for women to start the small businesses that will help them now, catapult them to another level where they can now get into more value-added businesses.
Service industry, sharing of information, where the opportunities
yes.
are. Now, Daktari, I'd want us to try and see how we can then address the issue of skills gap. And the government has been pushing for a campaign to have more women come on board in as far as STEM, and as far as education is concerned, STEM studies. You're a lecturer in economics. I took an elective in economics. I do not want to remember those days when I was studying for an economics paper. Okay. But we are here. We're fine. At least we understand, you know, how money moves and such. Yes. But now, how do we then, you see, we have the program, but then how do we tackle the need and the feel that I can do it as a woman, that I can study economics, that I can study physics and such? How do you change that? From where you sit, Dr. Ari?
I think it all begins with oneself, to realize that we can make it, and to have that confidence, and to know that the sky is not the limit, you know, and go for it. Because it is one thing, we are also seeing women that are doing very well in those sectors. So we should learn, or women should be able to learn from, you know, those successful women that are engaged in, you know, are pilots or are doing that big industry. And we have good examples in Kenya. And that is a lesson to the woman, that women can make it. Women can be economists. Women can be doctors. And we know it. We have many women doctors. Women can work in the engineering sector, and they can do in business. So it starts with change of mind, with one, to realize that, yes, it can be, I can study physics, the girl child when they're in school, to stop this idea of, you know, thinking mathematics is difficult, you know, physics is difficult, economics is difficult, it's not for ladies. And also to change the mind and know that anyone can do it. You know, also when you were in school, that thinking was there, maths is not really for girls, it's mainly for boys, physics and so on. But we know that there is experience, there is already enough experience of what we can see that even women can make it. So it begins with oneself to change. And also another thing is kind of mentorship, because we do have women that have done it big in businesses, for example, in economics, or who are heading big companies, and, you know, to provide kind of, you know, encouragement and mentorship to those that are, for example, in high school or in university, that this is possible, because that change is needed for one to be able, you know, to participate in such spheres of life. The other thing is affirmative action, because it is important that women are given the opportunity. You know, when we know that there's a gap that is existing, the next thing, we don't have to treat them equally. But that doesn't mean we overlook the skill requirements, or we overlook, you know, the basic standard which is needed. But we don't have to have the same scale, you know, of standard for both men and women. So what my colleague has explained here, when we know that women are you know, they are qualified, they don't have to be 100%. We can take 80% qualification for women, and men we can take like 90% for the position that we want.
Now,
and
that becomes very controversial, because we've had this conversation, issues of gender equality, gender equity, gender parity, all that, with some critics coming up and saying that so much has been given to the women, and the men are lagging behind. Let's rope in our researcher, Jerry, Madam Jerry. What do you think about that narrative that is, we have done so much for women, and the, you know, the men are lagging behind, the boy child is lagging behind? From where you sit, is it?
I don't think that's the case. And as I started earlier saying, the historical issues that have led women to lag behind are still there. They have not changed. Even now, you still find more women going, men going up to university, and fewer women getting there. Then you find men are advantaged by culture and other patriarchal issues that they generally automatically inherit. Although the law changed that both men and women can inherit, the attitude is still there, and you find still some families will not allow women to inherit. So in terms of, say, legally, the legislation is there that women can inherit, but what is the practicality of that? We have laws that say, let's do affirmative action, let's have the government start these funds. The law is there. But are women actually accessing these funds to, you know. So when these people say that we've given them so much, let's look at what is on the books.
The situation
and what
on
is the
ground.
Reality.
Yeah.
Yes, the reality does not really match with
does not. There's no correlation with what has been put in paper what is actual on ground.
And part of the reason is because when policies are done, who is at the top?
Good question. That's where I was going. Mm-hmm. Talking about leadership and governance. Mm-hmm. Do you think that if we had, you know, more representation in as far as leadership and governance is concerned in this country, that would actually harness more of the woman's potential as far as economic development is concerned? Dr.
Yes, I would think so. This is because as a woman, I would also understand those barriers, and some of the barriers really are because of that extra responsibility that the woman take at home. For example, for one to get to employment and also promotion, you know, it depends on things like networking, you know, that one has to go through in the process, and also issues related to, you know, the time spent at home. Because, for example, a woman who is working in a certain whatever place it is, when they are childbearing, when they get a baby, they take another responsibility. They stay home, for example, 3 months. Mm-hmm. When they come back, the colleagues that, the male colleagues that were, they were employed together, probably they are moved a step ahead when it comes to experience. So those kind of issues, those extra responsibilities, and which, you know, women take on, sometimes they put them behind. It's not because they are not qualified. It's not because they can't make it. If they stayed in the workplace for the 3 months, they were at the maternity leave, they would be at the same level with their colleagues, or they would be ahead. But the point is if I'm in a decision-making place, I would understand what women go through. I appreciate, because those, what we are calling the non-productive activities or the extra work that the woman does at home, the ironing of clothes, the taking care of the babies, is critical for the running of the family and the economy. And it has to be done. And it seems women grandly take it. So it is important. When I'm in decision making, I would be able to understand that a woman has an extra responsibility, and also I could try to look for more opportunities for them, and also try to create convenience for them so that they can be able to do those other responsibilities and be able to work. For example, I would think of a situation where I can create a childcare facilities so that a mother who is 3 months, the baby is 3 months, and she wants to come to work, she can bring her baby to a childcare facility at the place of work, so that she knows my baby is there at break time. I can check on this baby at lunchtime. I can check on this baby, and that way their productivity increases. Yes.
Now I've heard you, Daktari, there that if a woman is in a decision-making position, then the whole community, everyone stands to benefit. But there's also the question that critics have asked then, if the women have the numbers and they know where they want to go, why aren't they going there? And let me drive this conversation towards our political scene, because we have elections. That's how we get to those leadership positions in as far as governance is concerned. Mm-hmm. If the women have the numbers, why don't we vote for our fellow women? From a research point of view, let's talk about it, because we're all talking about succession politics of 2022, and we're seeing how things are changing every day.
Yeah.
But we're seeing women are not represented as far as we're talking about succession politics of 2022.
Yeah.
Yet we have established that if we have a woman in a decision-making position, then we can change the narrative. What does the research and the statistics say,
madam? I think the politics is a difficult game, in the sense that it's not just women can vote and they can vote for their own, but we are talking about structures as well. Mm-hmm. Who owns the political parties? Mm-hmm. How do women access these political parties? And if they create their own, what kind of support do they get? So there are many dynamics to it, because we are looking, I guess the deciding factor is, if I'm campaigning, for example, in Dagoretti, which party actually will give me the votes to get there? Mm-hmm. And once you get into that party, the norms that govern it sometimes disadvantage you. That's one aspect. The other aspect which we keep hampering is still that cultural thing. And the you know, there are many calculations that you have to make. If I'm campaigning in Dagoretti, which party is the likely one to win? So I go join that party. Then the structures there determine many other things. The women who are voting also have dynamics within the home, the family, mm-hmm. you know, and the homestead, mm-hmm. and ethnic issues. There are many,
it's
many issues.
It's a couple of so many things.
So why women don't vote for their own is a question that cannot be answered by one factor. There are several factors that to think about.
I want to bring up now the role mm-hmm. that men can play to ensure mm-hmm. that women have their position at the table. Do we need the men to actually come on board so that we can, you know, realize the women's potential as far as economic development is concerned? I don't know. I'm torn between Madam Jerry and the country that
I just wanted to continue on that line to say it's men. You talked about elections.
Yeah.
If the political parties, what is it called? The legal framework yeah. that governs the party
political
is inclusive.
Political Parties Act. Yeah.
The Political Parties Act. If it's inclusive in terms of ensuring that there's gender parity within the party, then women are likely to rise, you know, in those top positions. But if that is not observed, even in terms of nominations, in terms of who gets a certificate, you know, we'll never get very far. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Uh-huh. The role of men when it comes to, you know, supporting women to realize their potential. Do we need the men to actually realize this?
Yes, we need men. Mm-hmm. Because this is a society, and if you look at the population of Kenya, for example, women would be like 51%, the rest are men. So we are, and these men, most of them are the ones who are in the decision-making place. If we look at the political sphere, majority are men. So, and they have to give, I mean, they have to take action that also will give women space to participate in the economy. Mm-hmm. For example, we are saying when it comes to, because they are the ones who are in decision making in the employment place, to ensure that there are policies that also favor women. When it comes to institutions, for example, for skills and capacity building, there are policies, because they are decision makers or managers or the leaders in those positions, to ensure that they bring in the gender parity in those places, the policies that encourage women to participate, for example, the requirements to join higher learning institutions, whether it's universities, whether it is the tertiary institutions and other skills development institutions. They have to ensure there is, affirmative action to ensure that a certain number of women is admitted to such institutions. And also, when we are doing employment, they also too, because they are the decision makers. And if you go, even if it was there's a technical team that is doing interviews, they also need to take. You find that majority are likely to be men.
Yeah.
So again, even in such spheres, they need to ensure they take care such that women candidates are also invited and women are also given space. So, and also the change of mind. You know, like you've talked about politics, and I've had this question coming up. Is Kenya ready for, you know, a woman
president?
Not only Kenya, not only Kenya.
The whole
even
world.
Globally, in the whole world. And then the question is, so what does it mean for a country to be ready for a female, you know, president or a female leader? I think that question has kept on coming. So again, we are saying that change of mind, even in men, to know that even a woman can lead, because we have seen big nations of the world being led by women, and they have done very well. So even businesses, we have seen women leaders in business who have done very well. So even the change of mind in men is important.
It's key.
It's key.
Now we have established that. Let's talk about the Women and the Economic Conference. This is going to be happening tomorrow and Thursday, and it's going to be happening in Nairobi as well as online. It's a hybrid conference.
Yes.
Tell us why anyone who is watching Daktari would actually want to either log in, follow the proceedings online, or physically attend this particular conference. What is there to look out for, Daktari?
Yeah, this conference, the objective is mainly to discuss ways of enhancing women participation in the economy, in all the spheres of the economy. So we have, anybody should be able to log in, whether they are business women, whether they are policymakers, whether they are private sector, whether they are academicians and so on, they need to log in, because there's a lot of learning to do, to see in this conference with regards to women participation in the economy, issues related to the opportunities, issues related to what the government is doing, the opportunities that are coming up with the government policy, because we will also have high-level speakers from the government talking about the access to finance, what government is doing. We will also have people that are well experienced in technology talking about what technology offers are there for women to participate in the economy, whether in agriculture, whether in the services sector, whatever sector they are involved in. Also, media personalities, they need to get in, because we also have a session that will be discussing on, putting the narrative forward that women can make it and women need to participate better in the economy. So basically, all the people in the walks of life, there's an offer for them. Mm-hmm. There's something they can learn from this economy with regards to women enhancement in participation in the economy in Kenya.
Yes, changing the narrative, something there for the media. We will be keenly focusing on that. But how do we get the details? Where do you get the details to log in, and how do we learn more about this upcoming conference? Is it available on your website? Maybe you can share that so that people can log in and see exactly what you just mentioned.
Yes, we have this available. We have it on Facebook. We have Twitter handle. We also have a website where we are put. I'll be giving it at the end of this
Actually,
discussion.
Just give it right now.
You okay. Tell us where details are in my phone, so uh-huh. I'll be getting them. So we what we need to do is you log in into the Women and the Economy Conference, uh-huh. and then one needs to register. There's a registration process, and when you register, then you get to get into the conference. Uh-huh. So there's a registration process. I'll give the details.
The Women and the Economic Conference.
Yes.
All I need is just check it online,
yes.
Then do the registration process.
Oh, yes.
Uh-huh. Available yes. to anyone.
Available to
it's
anyone.
It's a hybrid, yes. What you're calling a hybrid conference. You can either attend at the studios, the CIO studios,
yes.
studies.
Yes.
I mean, yes, studios tomorrow. And Thursday.
Yes.
Parting shot, Dr. Ari, before I rope in our lecturer to just give us, our researcher, sorry, to give us a word in as far as, economic empowerment and the role that women should play. One word.
Women need to participate in the marketplace for the Kenyan economy to develop in a sustainable manner.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Madam Jerry, mm-hmm. One word. As we come to a close, give us a summary.
Yeah, I think it's very important that women get economically empowered, because all these issues we are raising about the politics, whatever business you want to do, economic empowerment is the starting point.
Mm. Yeah. Very well said. I'm not trying to water down the conversation that we've had this morning. What you need to know as a woman out there, we need to embrace what is called change from within so that we can change without. It begins with you. I'm Regina Manyara. Let's meet tomorrow, same time, for a fun-packed and informative show that is Good Morning Kenya. I wish you a great day ahead. What